Welcome to the Menopause Learning Podcast. This is a special continuing medical education podcast, and this is for physicians, physician assistants, nurse practitioners, and registered pharmacists. I am your host, Dr. Holly Thacker, and I'm the Executive Director of National Speaking of Women's Health. This podcast today, in April of 2023, is sponsored by a grant by Astellas and Bayer in conjunction with Rush University, Plexus Communications, Advancing Health After Hysterectomy, and Speaking of Women's Health. And you can find out more information about this program and the free CME and other podcast episodes on menopauselearning.com. Joining us today in this episode is Dr. Tara Iyer. Dr. Iyer is a NAMS certified menopause specialist, and she's currently working as the lead physician at Brigham and Women's Menopause and Midlife Clinic in the Fish Center for Women's Health. And she's a clinical instructor at Harvard Medical School. She's a board-certified family medicine physician, and she specializes in women's health, menopausal care, and weight management medicine. She received her MD from the Rutgers Robert Wood Johnson Medical School. She completed her residency with an obstetrics and women's health tract at St. Joseph's Hospital Family Medicine Residency in Denver, Colorado. And then I am so proud to say she completed a two-year specialized women's health fellowship with me and my colleagues at the Center for Specialized Women's Health at Cleveland Clinic. And she, of course, was just absolutely stellar. Dr. Iyer is also board certified in obesity medicine, and she works as an attending physician at the Center for Weight Management and Wellness within the endocrine division of Brigham and Women's Hospital. And she intends to foster stronger clinical and research partnerships between the Division of Women's Health and the Center for Weight Management and Wellness to create a more comprehensive and collaborative approach to the management of midlife women's health issues. So thank you so much for joining us, Dr. Iyer.
Thanks so much for having me, Dr. Thacker.
So this grant arose from the need to look at non-hormonal options to treat vasomotor symptoms. On menopauselearning.com, we have other free CME about hormone therapy and menopause. But in all the surveys that are ever done on midlife women's health, certainly in the United States as well as other countries, weight is the number one concern that midlife women have. And even though that's not a classic menopausal symptom, I think that everyone listening to this podcast is going to have experience with their patients, themselves or their family members concerned about weight gain that occurs with age. So do you want to talk a little bit about the changes that occur to the body metabolically throughout the menopause transition and how this negatively affects body composition?
Absolutely. And I completely agree. It's probably one of the number one issues that comes up, concerns that really affect my patients, particularly when they're coming in perimenopause and menopause. I would say it's up there with how much I hear things like hot flashes and night sweats, weight gain, or just a real difficulty with losing any weight, really stubborn weight, particularly around the midsection, is one of the biggest complaints that I hear, which is actually how I ended up wanting to pursue an obesity medicine board certification and learn more about that particular field.
So we always look at lifestyle modifications first whenever we're talking about any medical condition or disease state. So what are your top lifestyle modifications to combat these changes and optimize the health that are most important for women at this stage in life?
Absolutely. So the main things that we're seeing, of course, partially just due to chronological aging, we are going to gain weight. There is particularly a decrease in lean muscle mass, which leads to a decrease overall basal metabolic rate, or what we classically think of as our metabolism. which means kind of sitting here having a conversation. A person in perimenopause is going to be burning less calories, living their everyday life, than 10 years prior. And so we see that decrease. And then when we lose estrogen, we also see an additional decrease, more lean muscle mass loss, lower basal metabolic rate, and lower, you know, overall metabolism. And then there's a shift in terms of body composition in general, how we store fat. So we gain total adiposity or total fat, and then how we store it, where it's stored on the body shifts. It could be all throughout. Some women have pear shape, but we tend to shift and then store more fat around the visceral section or abdominal section after losing our hormones. So particularly what I tend to stress with my patients, obviously we always talk about diet and exercise when with regard to weight, especially at this transition. The number one things I emphasize with regard to diet are hitting protein goals, making sure we're getting clean sources of protein, lean protein in an adequate amount so that any weight loss we do, we make sure that we retain muscle mass with that. And then when we talk about what kind of lifestyle changes we can make with regard to exercise, strength training to build back some of that muscle that we're losing and increase our basal metabolic rate, increase our overall metabolism, is really the main things that we want to focus on. So those are some of the main issues.
And do you think that there's utility in recommending that perimenopausal women, women before the final menstrual period, work to lose 5 to 10 pounds in anticipation of the expected usual 15 pounds of menopausal transition?
100%. I would say it's so much easier to lose the weight prior to entering any time where you're going to have those hormonal shifts. Not only, right, we have the shifts because biologically there's a change going on in our hormones, chronologically we are aging, but the symptoms that are caused by that, whether or not you use any type of therapy to relieve them, are going to then provoke more waking. If you're not sleeping, having terrible night sweats that wake you up, you're chronically stressed, you have more anxiety, you know, you're feeling fatigued all the time, all these things are going to lead to increased weight gain in women. It is much easier to lose it prior to that stage.
And so you're not worried about provoking any kind of eating disorders or body dysmorphia or anything like that?
No, I don't believe so in how we educate patients, because particularly what I want to emphasize or what I tend to emphasize with my patients is we can't think of it like a diet. We really have to think about this is a lifestyle that I'm living and what are my goals? If my goal is to optimize my health and feel as good as I possibly can on an everyday basis, the way to do that is not by starving yourself. It's not by going on very, very low-calorie diets. It's by moving your body, listening to your body, participating in movements that strengthen your body, strengthen your muscles, and certainly moving your body to get those endorphins, and then choosing high-quality products to that really nourish your body with the right macronutrients.
And so do you think that the food pyramid and all the seed oils and all the processed foods and the additives, how much of that do you think has contributed to America's obesity problem versus lifestyle of people being more sedentary and not needing to do physical work or any other thoughts? Because it's really exploded, yeah. No pun intended.
Right. Honestly, I think it's absolutely both of those things. The food probably more so predominantly. It's one of those things when patients will often ask about sort of the 80-20 rule, if there's really any validity to that, meaning 80% about weight loss and weight maintenance is diet and 20% is exercise. You know, I tend to tell them, no matter what you do, you can't really outwork a really poor diet, especially in the perimenopausal and menopausal phases of life, right? Maybe when you're, 19, 18, it's a different story. But certainly as we age, and the onset and sort of increase in really unhealthy, highly processed foods, particularly in America, is one of the leading causes of why there's such a high prevalence of obesity at this point. But you're right in terms of sedentary, that's that nature, right? That isn't how people used to live. And increasingly, it is more. And now with the onset after the pandemic, even more so, right? So certainly that contributes.
Yeah, there was like significant weight gain in most all age groups, I believe, during the pandemic.
I've seen several studies that have said that.
Yeah. So a lot of patients, of course, want individualized care, just like they want, if they're going to be on hormone therapy, to be completely individualized, or they want just precision individualized medicine. Where do you think we are in terms of pharmacogenomics, in terms of diet? Because some people say they feel better on a higher carb, you know, complex carb diet. And then there's others that just say, oh, their thinking is better and their appetite's suppressed when they're on a higher fat, higher protein, more keto diet.
Yeah.
So do you think we're to the point where it's worthwhile for women to pay for that nutrigenomic testing?
So I do think that there is some validity to it. It honestly hasn't been studied well enough at this point that I would say it would be recommended and we'd really see a significant difference. Certainly there's no really extensive randomized control trials that have really been able to delve into that data. But anecdotally speaking, you know, women certainly don't follow the same pattern across the board. And we've seen that again and again when we control head to head different diets, looking at what are the outcomes here. So people definitely respond differently, and their body tends to process food differently, work differently with respect to certain types of diets, which is why it really matters more what macronutrients are you getting in and eating closer to whole unprocessed foods, as opposed to our particular type of diet, a certain amount exactly of carbohydrates or a certain amount of, you know, Atkins versus keto versus Mediterranean versus overall calorie content, overall how are you moving your body, and what is the quality of the food tends to matter more. But certainly I've had some women who only have success in certain diets.
And what's your position medically in midlife women in terms of intermittent fasting? And is the timing of when someone eats important?
I absolutely do think so. There's been a little bit of controversy in terms of what does the data show, but certainly the overwhelming amount of evidence really points to, in more particularly, we want to avoid calories late at night and eat something in a cycle that is more in tune with the circadian rhythm that's natural. Eating when the sun's up and making sure we're cutting out calories when after kind of the sun sets. And that really is more helpful for sleep cycles. That's more helpful in terms of how we process calories. There is data to show that calories that are processed closer to nighttime literally are processed differently than in the morning. So, you know, in terms of intermittent fasting, where I've seen the most success is when you are keeping that schedule, a 16-8 or even a 5-2, but a 16-hour fast, 8 hours while you're actually eating, but keeping that on the earlier side, the earlier the better.
The earlier the better, mm-hmm. Yeah. So going 2 p.m., you know, till 8 p.m. or 10 p.m. isn't so optimal.
Absolutely not, yeah.
So, I've had some women who've intermittently fasted the typical 8 hours of, you know, two meals or so, maybe a snack, and then 16 strict hours of fasting and not have any benefit. And they've had better benefit when they do like 1 or 2 days of just only bone broth or only 400 or 500 calorie meal. What do you think about that? And what do physicians have to watch for cardiometabolically if people are going to fast mm-hmm. like that? And certainly religiously, I'm thinking, you know, we're in the Holy Week right now, there's, you know, a fair bit of fasting going on.
Yeah, so that is actually more in line with, certainly less popular, but another style of intermittent fasting, the 5-2 style, where 5 days a week you're probably eating a fairly typical diet within normal hours that you would particularly eat, and then 2 days a week you're eating only low calorie, probably around 400 to 500 calorie, and fasting for the rest of the day. I have had a lot of women have success on that particular diet. And I do think there are a lot of benefits, and that has been displayed in the literature, the benefits of fasting in particular, whether or not it's the 16-8 or the 5-2, that has sort of nothing to do even with weight outside of that. There are some mortality benefits. There's certainly some cardiometabolic benefits. You know, how extensive they are and really what is it in reference to? Is it because these women might be losing weight? Is it because they might be making healthier choices? You know, it's hard to say in that regard. I don't think that they've been controlled well for biases over this many decades, unfortunately. But certainly we have seen benefits.
We'll be back after a quick break.
Hey, quick question for you. Are you someone who wants to be fit, healthy, and happy? And what if I told you you could get your dream body by simply just listening to a podcast? I'm Josh.
And I'm KG, and we are the hosts of the Fit, Healthy, and Happy podcast.
Listen, we get it. Fitness isn't easy. Carbs, no carbs.
Just stop, okay? It doesn't have to be that complicated. And that's why we made this podcast. We get straight to the facts so you can become your best you.
So the way to check us out is click the link in the show notes or search Fit, Healthy, and Happy podcast on any of the major podcast platforms. We'll see you soon.
So since the field of menopause, which we practice every day, is really anti-aging medicine, mm-hmm. like I like to say, without the snake oil, I certainly, for most adults, you know, that are not pregnant, that don't have severe migraines or, you know, brittle diabetes, I generally recommend most adults should be intermittently fasting and, you know, to reduce the risk of diabetes, at least in animals, which we can control mm-hmm. in the lab, is really pretty clear. Mm-hmm. Now, tell us what the utility of using menopausal hormone therapy in terms of lean body composition, body weight, and a lot of women think that hormones are going to make them fat, but they don't realize it really helps them sleep, which reduces cortisol and so forth.
Mm-hmm. So there's a lot of benefits, and particularly if I have patients when one of their main concerns is weight gain, certainly we look at all the symptoms before we talk about any type of treatment. But in regard particularly to weight, and if they're having symptoms that are really causing, as you mentioned, if we're not sleeping, if we're completely fatigued, you know, that's going to drive your cortisol levels up, which drives your appetite up, particularly your appetite for unhealthy foods, carbohydrate-rich foods. If you're fatigued and have no energy, it's harder to stick to any kind of exercise regimen as well. And then if we don't get enough sleep, right, obviously that leads to weight gain at the same time. So when we have those symptoms, certainly there's a benefit for hormone therapy in terms of resolving those things that will allow us to live healthier lifestyles. But supplementing the hormones too certainly has a role. And I would call hormone therapy either weight neutral or helpful with regard to weight loss. Certainly, there's absolutely no evidence in the literature over several years that it leads to any weight gain. Some women do notice a little bit of water retention, but typically that does mean that maybe the dose is too high for you, or we need to cut down on salt in the diet. We need to look at other factors. We need to look at what we're eating, and we need to drink more water. Right. So I would say I counsel women, you may notice a little bit of water retention, but it's certainly not fat. It's certainly not actual weight gain, and that we will certainly improve symptoms that are leading to further weight gain in addition to getting your hormones back, which can mitigate any further lean muscle mass loss and any further negative redistribution of adipose tissue gain that happens when we lose hormones, and then the shift to visceral adipose gain or abdominal adipose gain that we see when we lose hormones. So we're mitigating those things. So essentially any intervention you would make would be more effective.
There was an interesting study that looked at transdermal estrogen versus oral conjugated estrogens in terms of epicardial fat, and actually saw less epicardial fat with conjugated estrogens. And I'm wondering, do you think that this is patient specific? Do you prefer oral versus transdermal? Do you think it doesn't make a difference, minus risk for venous thromboembolism? I mean, most of the mm-hmm. long-term studies that have shown decreased death rates and decreased cardiovascular disease have just simply been with orals.
Yeah. Now, I would say that, unfortunately, particularly where it comes to weight, we don't have enough evidence between the two different formulations to say one way or another. I have seen that there's some studies that say there is slightly higher concentrations of estrone when you're using oral therapy as opposed to transdermal therapy. in particular, that may also affect your cardiometabolic health. But then I've seen exactly what you've mentioned in terms of the studies that particularly maybe oral might be more preferable with regard to certain cardiometabolic risk factors, particularly if we're talking about what is the difference between blood pressure and cholesterol when you're using one versus the other. You know, so I don't think we have enough data to distinguish what is the difference with regard to weight in particular, but I'm hoping to work on that research myself, actually.
Oh, that's great. What do you do with women who say that despite weightlifting and doing more bodybuilding type activities, the sarcopenia is such they don't feel like they're building muscle and they ask you for testosterone? What's the data with testosterone and body composition in women?
Yeah, so certainly testosterone absolutely, I think, plays a role, especially if we're on the lower side of what is considered normal range or deficient. I will say when I have patients who just feel like no matter what strides they're making, we're really confident in their protein intake, we're really confident in their strength training regimen, and we're really confident in their estrogen and their hormones, if they're already on hormone therapy and they're still not making any gains or progress, still having issues, that is something that I would check in particular. Certainly total testosterone, but likely a total and a free. And if that is on the lower side of normal or if it is deficient, they absolutely can have some benefit if we supplement that, not only in terms of energy, but in terms of lean muscle mass retention, because we do know if we don't have enough testosterone, you're going to have difficulties with lean muscle mass retention, certainly with building lean muscle and potentially even decrease lean muscle mass, which is certainly one of the reasons as we chronologically get older, another outside of estrogen, we have a little bit less lean muscle mass.
Now, of course, there's been this proliferation of these anti-aging clinics and unregulated hormones and pellet injections, which aren't FDA approved. And I've seen disaster cases almost every week with women who have testosterone levels higher than men. And I've certainly seen masculinizing effects, which do include weight gain. So it seems like it's a very careful balance. And unfortunately, we don't have the testosterone patch, which was studied in women several years ago, mm-hmm. to have any kind of dosage control.
Yeah, and I usually try to aim just within the guidelines that we do have, that we do know are safe, on the higher end of what is normal in a premenopausal woman, as sort of my top maximum. Certainly also we would guide by, do you have any masculinizing side effects?
Now, in terms of looking at comorbid medical conditions and medications that may actually be positive in terms of anti-aging and weight, like say glucophage, metformin, mm-hmm. or other medications we use for other conditions, do you want to just do any kind of categorization of certain medicines that tend to cause weight gain that we need to be worried about if we're giving it to patients, and then the medications that actually may help suppress appetite?
Yeah, absolutely. So in pretty much any evaluation that I would do when someone is coming in with the main complaint of weight gain or difficulty losing weight, one of the first things I do is look through their medication list. And there are surprisingly an overwhelming and honestly surprising amount of medications that actually can lead to weight gain. Particularly in midlife, the ones that I see that come up the most are SSRIs and SNRIs, which are antidepressant, anti-anxiety medications. Those in particular, absolutely, with a dose dependency, and certainly some formulations more so than others, can lead to weight gain fairly prominently. And there are many people who were started on them in perimenopause for mood changes or for hot flashes and night sweats, with a complaint of weight gain that has just made that weight gain and potentially sexual dysfunction worse, right? The same with gabapentin. I have several patients who come in, their main complaint was weight gain, but they were actually put on gabapentin for hot flashes and night sweats, and then particularly gained more weight on that. The other things that I often see coming up at this age, so other psychological medications, particularly atypical antipsychotics, they come up quite often. Medications like... So what we see, obviously, mirtazapine is one of the biggest offenders, though that comes in less often. But I often have patients on things like Seroquel or Risperdone who had no idea that that might be affecting them.
Yeah, for sleep disorders.
Exactly, which a lot of times is menopausal as well. And then I also see, I think, a decent amount of patients on beta blockers, which is another really primary offender. A lot of times too, patients don't even know why they're on them. They say it's for blood pressure, knowing though that it's not even the most effective medication for blood pressure, and they've just been on it for a little bit of time and not really noticed that it has been leading to increased weight gain or exercise intolerance in them, which further actually makes it more difficult to lose weight then.
And obviously glucocorticoids, especially in high doses in some people. Now, medicines that are used for anticonvulsant therapies and migraine medicines like Topamax, isn't that in some prescription weight loss, or is that used specifically to suppress appetite?
Absolutely. So it is in – so topiramate particularly, we can use independently to help with weight. But it's also in a popular, well-studied weight loss medication, one component of Qsymia, which is the brand name, which is phentermine and topiramate, which works synergistically with phentermine to decrease overall appetite. And certainly the topiramate aspect can decrease some of the anxiety you might experience while being on phentermine, certainly help with sleep if that's disrupting your, if the phentermine is disrupting your sleep cycles. So they certainly work synergistically, but topiramate has independent effects also of decreasing sort of carb cravings in particular. It can even cause dysgeusia, particularly with soda, meaning patients who really have an addiction to soda or really just can't shake it can make soda taste flat and weird to them, just not taste good. So I've often used it in that one instance.
We'll be back after a quick break.
Have you ever experienced fitness failure? You know, you set a goal to exercise, you're all excited, and then you're not. Hi, I'm Dave. I host the daily 10-minute podcast, Walking is Fitness. Instead of an exercise goal, I talk about making a fitness promise. And every day you keep that promise, you add another link to a growing fitness chain. This is a podcast of action. You'll create a fitness habit, which eventually becomes fitness momentum, and then on to all kinds of good stuff. Check it out. Walking is Fitness, and let's take a daily 10-minute walk together.
Oh, interesting, interesting. Now, there's issues in terms of drug-drug interactions and side effects, and rarely like Stevens-Johnson syndrome, so do you have to do regular lab testing?
I get labs in an initial panel with everyone who comes in the door if they don't have up-to-date labs. Usually I'm checking what do their lipids look like, their basal metabolic panel, hepatic function panel, vitamin D, as it's particularly also low in several patients with obesity or who are overweight, hemoglobin A1C. And of course, thyroid function. And then in my menopause and midlife clinic at the same time, or if just in midlife women, I sometimes will also look at their reproductive hormones, estradiol and FSH, if I feel like that's a contributing factor as well. And then based on what we prescribe, we monitor.
Now, this is April of 2023, and we don't yet have either of the two KNDy neuron antagonists that are being studied for vasomotor symptoms. Do you think if they come to market, and hopefully, you know, fezolinetant will be available in a 45 milligram daily dose based on the research and prior podcast on this menopauselearning.com series, which you're listening to, which has free CME on go to menopauselearning.com or Convey Medical app to listen to our other podcast CME interviews on this. Do you think since those agents are weight neutral, that if more people use those medicines as opposed to high dose SSRIs that are associated with weight gain, like Paxil and some of the atypical antipsychotics that are used for sleep disorder, do you think that will help in terms of medical and weight management?
I absolutely think so. I really, really hesitate to use gabapentin or SSRIs or SNRIs in my menopausal patients because almost all of them complain about weight gain, and I don't want to make that any more difficult for them.
What about antidepressants like bupropion, which are not SNRIs or SSRIs that affect dopamine?
So I use bupropion specifically often, and that's also part of a well-studied and very efficacious medication called Contrave. That is bupropion and naltrexone, a combination of those two, brand name is Contrave, which particularly is really helpful to decrease food cravings, decrease sort of the emotional stress response that causes a lot of food issues in the general population, but particularly women. But I will use that often when people have, particularly when people have mood disorders or a lot of fatigue or a lot of stress or emotional or bored eating.
Now, is what's the dose of Contrave of both those two medications?
So Contrave can be up titrated, but typically the dose will be about 8 milligrams of naltrexone to 90 milligrams of bupropion twice a day. But I usually prescribe the generic, and how I typically prescribe it is either 100 milligrams or 150 milligrams of the SR release, sustained release bupropion twice a day, in addition to the best we have for generic for naltrexone is usually about 50 milligrams. So I do half of that tablet twice a day.
So I know in functional medicine, they use much, much lower doses of naltrexone to block inflammation or make the opioid receptors, I guess, more sensitized.
Mm-hmm.
So to prescribe medications like Contrave or separating the two and doing the two generics or Qsymia, which is the phentermine and Topamax, can regular licensed prescribers, including APPs, prescribe them? Does it vary state to state? Do you have to get certified to prescribe these medications?
No. At this point, there isn't a special certification that is required to prescribe these medications. All that's really necessary is patient requirements. Are the patients, what is their BMI? Is it above 27 with a comorbidity, between 27 and 30 with a comorbidity, or above 30 generally?
Now, so contraindications to these medications, obviously with bupropion, would be seizure disorder or severe anxiety.
Mm-hmm.
Any contraindications to the naltrexone?
The naltrexone, I particularly ask about, no big significant contraindications, but I particularly ask about what is your history of opioid and alcohol abuse and is there any changes there, because that would be pertinent information for me.
Uh-huh. And in terms of other centrally acting medications, flibanserin or Addy, which previously you had to, quote, get certified to prescribe and have people fill out they weren't going to drink alcohol. Now that's totally defunct, and alcohol can raise those levels. Anything that goes through the cytochrome P450 in the liver can either increase metabolism or decrease metabolism. So obviously drug-drug interactions with any medications in the patient's medicine list have to be looked at. But that multi-channel serotonergic agent in some women improves sleep and actually is associated with weight loss. Mm-hmm. Do you ever use that as an adjunct off-label or only in those women that fit hypoactive sexual desire disorder?
I tend to only use it in women who have hypoactive sexual desire disorder, but it would further convince me that one route, certainly, and I tend to use it in my counseling when we're making a choice about what to use for sexual dysfunction. If they also have weight gain, I would, especially if they have sleep issues, if they have other things in addition to the sexual dysfunction, I would absolutely use that as a selling point, or that might push us in one direction.
Yeah, the problem with these medications that insurance considers lifestyle, whether they're for sexual function or even standard hormone therapy, which is old and cheap and been around, you know, for 80 plus years, many times just the whole prior auths, and we haven't even gotten into the newer class of exciting obesity medicines, which we will soon do, and it's certainly such a hot topic. In fact, my PhD son, who's got his PhD in molecular medicine and cancer genetics, he said he doesn't think there's going to be any obesity in America in 30 years because of these peptides.
Mm-hmm.
So do you think that's a possibility?
If these medicines become widely covered by insurance and they increase their production and the companies that are supplying the medications, then it absolutely is a possibility. Certainly, though, that means that people would be staying on these medications long term, which we don't necessarily know what that looks like yet.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so people are going to have to stay tuned. But in one of the earlier Menopause Learning CME podcasts that I did with Dr. James Simon, who went into a lot of the detail of the NK3 and NK1 candy neuron antagonist, he talked about the whole interaction with peptides at the brain level in terms of sexual function, satiety, thermoregulation, and all the, you know, important interactions. I mean, obviously all the actions, you know, really at the brain level, which is directing everything. But going, talking about other common medications in practice, where do you see metformin and glucophage fit in terms of anti-aging, anti-obesity, anti-diabetic, et cetera?
Yeah, I mean, that is still sort of one of the number one recommended treatments, first line treatment that everyone should be on who is a diabetic. I don't hesitate to use it even in the pre-diabetic state, and I think most physicians are leaning that way as well, because for me in particular, the really extensive data about its particular benefits in terms of mortality and anti-aging, whether you have insulin resistance or not. So I do think that it is a valuable medication. I think there's going to be more and more with regard to its function that comes up over the years that has nothing to do with insulin resistance only, right? So people who don't have a pre-diabetic diagnosis or people who don't have a diabetes diagnosis, how does this work and how does it function driving down our insulin levels and levels of insulin resistance completely? Is there a role for that? Which I think there will be.
Well, certainly always like to go over with the residents and the fellows how, even though you're dealing with maybe a post-reproductive aged person, that you still want to know what the obstetrical history is. And certainly gestational diabetes and preeclampsia, you know, portend a lot of metabolic problems. A history of infertility because a polycystic ovary condition is another one. And gestational diabetes is associated with a very high risk of sleep apnea. Do you know why that is, independent of weight? It just seems like there's a very strong association. And obviously, people with untreated sleep apnea tend to have bad metabolic indices and weight gain and fatigue.
Yeah, and that's something, I mean, and I think more and more we're going to see that in the literature. It's most recently popped up in the last sort of 5 or 10 years, I feel like, the guidelines have been changing, that is such a significant indicator, a history of gestational diabetes. In particular, I can now get coverage for some medications, even when people are not pre-diabetic or diabetic. Some insurances are covering those GLP-1 medications or some other medications with just a history of gestational diabetes, because we know it's such a strong indicator of negative metabolic health. So I think there's going to be more and more literature about that, particularly with obstructive sleep apnea. It's hard to say. I haven't read anything, any studies in particular that shows why that might be such a high correlation despite what somebody's BMI is.
Now, what about the whole field of gut microbiome and fecal transplants for different conditions and assaying stools for, you know, bifidobacteria in terms of incidence? Where is all that in terms of the obesity field?
So there's a lot more research. We're actually sort of, I think, on the forefront of it right now. There's a lot more research that your gut microbiome is almost directly related to obesity. You know, there has been pretty extensive research that particularly certain concentrations of different bacteria, some negative concentrations or a history of some conditions or antibiotic use or different things that might have altered your microbiome or made it more negative, lead to higher concentrations or higher prevalence of obesity. So I think we're going to learn more and more about that. What is the ideal microbiome? That I don't think we've landed on exactly yet, but certainly higher concentrations of certain bacteria that we know about already are linked to lower incidence of obesity and diabetes.
So is there anything specific that you recommend in terms of ingesting, you know, probiotics, prebiotics? I have these patients who bring in these bags of all these supplements. You don't know, they're not regulated. You don't know what, sometimes even they don't have expiration dates or lot numbers. And I would think if something has a probiotic in it, it shouldn't be exposed to heat or other chemicals. So I'm thinking it's just sitting out on the shelf. Like, are they just wasting their money? And then in terms of food sources, I've even heard gastroenterologists lecture and kefir, which is supposed to have a lot of bifidobacteria, certain brands may not have it in it. So like, what is a person to do, and what food should we try to focus on to get prebiotics and probiotics?
Yeah, and I would say kind of one of the big things too, I think that people tend to focus on, is that they can continue eating sort of whatever they want and then just add in a pill of a probiotic, and that will totally change their gut microbiome. And unfortunately, doesn't. I wish it worked that way. It doesn't. Unfortunately, doesn't work that way. I tend to focus on more counseling based on you really have to change your entire approach to what you're eating. Certainly, I would want to talk about and would want people to add in more prebiotic foods. So the foods that feed the good bacteria that you have, and then potentially probiotic foods, things like kefir, you know, obviously which brand in particular, don't have really strict recommendations on that just because we don't have studies that have been done head to head versus all the brands. But kefir certainly works well, sauerkraut, any kind of pickled food, certainly different yogurts, certain cottage cheese, you know, all of those foods can be really helpful in terms of improving your gut microbiome. But at the end of the day, you do have to make sure you're limiting processed foods and a lot of sugars, which are going to adversely and very negatively affect your gut microbiome.
And is there anything to thermogenic foods? My husband, who doesn't always like my spicy cooking and says garlic is my perfume of choice and my favorite food is jalapenos and hot sauce, he sent me this little meme that said, oh, people that eat spicy foods live longer.
You know, there is limited data that does suggest, I would say it's very limited, but there is limited data that does suggest there are certain foods that potentially would be more metabolically advantageous than other foods. You know, certainly spicy foods would be in that category. It's hard to say in regard to weight loss. There definitely hasn't been any sort of real pilot studies, real sort of randomized control trials that have looked at just the addition of, say, certain spicy foods making a big difference in terms of weight. But I think it makes sense. I think I would never say, unless you had, you know, GERD or reflux or some other type of contraindication to eating spicy foods, I would never say, I would say it would only help, right? The other thing in particular I think it probably helps with is when you're eating spicy foods, you drink more water. And I would prefer my patients drink more and more water because they will get more full and eat much less, which I have found is an issue in so many patients.
Now, are you evaluating body composition? We talked a little bit in an earlier podcast on osteoporosis with Dr. DeSapri about, you know, using DEXA to do body fat and lean body mass analysis. Are you incorporating that in your practice? Are you just doing it only in certain, you know, athletes or high performance people? I know insurance generally doesn't cover it. Do you think that there's a role in that? Because BMI is not all it's cracked up to be, obviously. Like my sons are all considered obese with BMIs of 30, and yet their body fat is definitely under 11% because they're just athletes and they have very dense, big muscles and big bones. And there are women, too, that are classified as obese who really, their weight circumference, their metabolic profile is such that I don't medically classify them as obese, but yet their healthcare plan considers them obese.
100%. I completely agree. But, you know, certainly BMI is very flawed in that it doesn't take into account muscle mass versus adipose tissue, which is probably one of the main things that really matters. In particular, we do know that waist circumference is a way better indicator of overall metabolic health. We at our clinic, we have access to both DEXA and Cica scans. Particularly Cica scans, we get a little bit better coverage for, which is really body composition analysis and will tell us. Sure. So when we get, so it's a body composition type of scale, and it does measure different compartments, right? It will tell you what is the level of adipose tissue, what is the percent of adipose tissue in the body, what is the lean muscle mass, what is that level, what is the percentage. And I find it particularly helpful, especially in patients who are going to lose a lot of weight, right? So patients who have a lot to lose, who start medicines like GLP-1 injectable medications, because they didn't discriminate in many of those studies, are they losing just adipose tissue or are they also losing muscle? And many of those patients are also losing muscle. So it's really important for us to know that and measure it over time so we can combat that and really appropriately manage their body composition.
Mm-hmm. And do you have any comments about the skinny fat people? Because certainly, you know, I do see petite people sometimes more likely to be maybe of Asian descent, small boned, and their BMI is still under 27, but they've really lost a lot of muscle mass, and clearly, you know, their waist has expanded, and they have glucose intolerance or frank diabetes and hypertension.
Yeah, and particularly it's interesting that you say that it's something that you've seen in Asian populations. I think this is a prime example of where we don't focus enough, or we kind of generalize with regards to ethnicity. Because actually, if you look at much larger population data, particularly in India, so South and Southeast Asia and Asia, really what, in terms of BMI, really what leads to poor metabolic outcomes is different than in most Caucasian and African American patients. So particularly what I would consider and what is considered to give you poor metabolic outcomes would be the in terms of what is the equivalent in, say, a Caucasian person. For Asian and Southeast Asian women, a BMI of above 25 is actually overweight, and a BMI of above 27 is actually obese, as opposed to in Caucasian women, where a BMI above 27 would be considered overweight, and a BMI of, or particularly where you could intervene with medications, right? So even in Asian women, it's actually a BMI of above 23 would be overweight, and below that would be metabolically healthy. But I think there should be, what I wish there was, is I consider using medications even above a BMI of 25 in my Asian and Southeast Asian patients.
And people too that have changed their baseline, or just based on their profile and just their also their bone structure. I have a patient who, of course, will remain unnamed, who was getting on the scale the other day in my office, and the nurse said, "Well, why aren't you putting down your purse and your heavy shoes?" She's like, "No, I'm standing on the scale with my stuff. This is my stuff," because she was afraid that she would just, you know, a very petite woman, but definitely had gained a lot of weight and had a lot of metabolic problems and needed treatment, was afraid that she would just miss that cutoff. So unfortunately, there's just, you know, it's a lot of, just like with a lot of things in terms of trying to get coverage, it's it can be challenging. So let's talk about the most exciting advances, which really have just expanded and exploded and so much to keep up with. Can you talk about the GLP-1 medications and also the dual action, you know, Mounjaro, the different categories? Are they the same in different doses? And when should we be looking to use these medicines or refer patients to people like you who are experts to use these medicines?
Yeah, so and it is interesting that you say that again, because you would hope it would be at the discretion of specialists and physicians, right, who should be allowed to take these medications, but unfortunately insurance coverage, we're sort of at their mercy a lot. So even though, like I said, if I had a patient who was Asian or Southeast Asian and had a BMI of 25 and had terrible metabolic health, you know, dyslipidemia and insulin resistance, I would love to put them on one of these medications, but they wouldn't get insurance coverage. So really, you have to go by what their guidelines are.
Unless they're carrying a really heavy purse.
Right. I mean, maybe we'll, yeah, be something to consider. But yeah, so we have to kind of go by the guidelines in that regard, in terms of what insurance will cover. So when these medications will be covered will be in the vast majority of cases, and again, it does depend by insurance, but if you have a BMI of 27 or greater and comorbid conditions such as dyslipidemia, hypertension, obstructive sleep apnea, you know, etc., or a BMI above 30. And I do tend to use those medications, and I will say I will get better coverage too, particularly if they have a history of insulin resistance in some regard, whether it's prediabetes, occasionally a history of gestational diabetes will do it, or overt diabetes.
How about PCOS?
I've had less luck with coverage with PCOS, but I have seen some insurances put that through, and maybe that is state dependent, because I actually got a little bit better or more, had more luck with that as a secondary indicator in Ohio than I'm having now in Massachusetts.
So yeah, there are definitely state differences.
Mm-hmm.
And so what about frank type 2 diabetes?
Frank type 2 diabetes will get you the best coverage in terms of all of them. I've seen so many more approvals go through with that because these medicines have probably have been around for about 15, you know, 10 to 15 years. As a diabetic medications. And I will say that's pretty much the only scenario I've been able to get Mounjaro covered. You know, some type of insulin resistance and good insurance, which Mounjaro we know is the most effective of our injectable medications, a dual GIP, GLP-1 medication that really acts to decrease appetite, increase satiety, and then certainly there are reward pathways in the brain that it disrupts because it can decrease overall cravings, particularly that you've had in the past.
Is that just sugar cravings or any kind of food cravings, or what about alcohol cravings or any other addictive behaviors?
So while we haven't seen it in the literature yet, I won't be surprised if it comes up. I have had patients report complete change in taste buds. I've had patients report a complete change in cravings, and that's true for whatever they particularly were interested in. So I've had patients who really only crave salty foods that they felt like that was completely gone. Or patients who really, particularly with rich foods or fat-filled foods or higher content fat foods, it tends to invoke a little bit more nausea, I think, in some of the patients. So I have had some patients who say even just the smell of certain foods, particularly that have high fat content, they're totally turned off by. Sugar cravings, sweet cravings, I've also seen be disrupted. So yeah, a lot of different, you know, changes with regard to cravings in general. And then I've also had a lot of patients say, particularly with alcohol, on both Ozempic, Wegovy, and Mounjaro, I've seen people just have less of a taste for it or less cravings for it. Certainly not generalizable to everybody, but I absolutely have seen it.
And so is Ozempic and Wegovy the same thing, just different doses? What's the generic name? And talk a little bit about the...
So the generic is semaglutide, and Ozempic and Wegovy are dosed differently. So Wegovy actually goes up to higher dosages, and it is FDA approved particularly just for weight loss. So you don't need to have any kind of insulin resistance if your BMI is above 30 to be on that medication. Ozempic technically, you know, produces weight loss, but is approved for diabetes and diabetic care. So we use it more often in prediabetes and diabetic patients, or if you can get coverage, whichever one you can use. Because I know a lot of state insurances and certainly Medicare in general do not cover weight loss medications like Wegovy and Saxenda that are studied for obesity.
So is Saxenda just has an indication for weight loss or weight loss and diabetes?
So Saxenda is the brand name for the weight loss version of liraglutide, which also has an indication and was initially studied and used at different dosages for diabetes.
And what's the name of that brand name?
Victoza.
Victoza. Okay. Mm-hmm. So the endocrinologists have been using this class of medication to treat diabetes for at least a decade.
Yeah, about a decade, I would say, is when it sort of, when they first kind of hit the market. And they've had a few other medications in there in that class. But by and large, I think probably the most prominent that work really well are semaglutide and liraglutide.
And those are generally higher doses than what you would treat for diabetes?
Correct.
Mm-hmm. And if you're using higher doses in patients with diabetes, do you have to be concerned about any kind of additive hypoglycemic effects? Because obviously you want more than just sugar control in type 2 diabetics. You also want weight loss usually as well if their BMI is elevated.
Absolutely. Yeah. So usually it certainly depends what other medications they're on that also may contribute to hypoglycemia in those patients. And then I would say the other consideration is making sure that you're reminding them that even though you might not be hungry, you still need to eat. And what you particularly eat is important. So it is something that is a concern, especially as weight goes down, cravings go down, as appetite goes down, to make sure that these patients are eating with some regularity and they're eating the correct foods to avoid any hypoglycemia.
And are there any contraindications with psychiatric disease? I mean, I certainly know that patients who lose their sense of smell and taste for various reasons, idiopathic, infectious, you know, cranial, etc., many of those patients become very depressed.
Yeah, and I will say there certainly have been some cases with these medication and incidence of depression. I mean, of course, you can say that with so many medications in particular, but I think it makes a lot of sense, you know, especially in patients who were using food as some type of coping mechanism for them or as a source of psychological comfort, there absolutely can be ramifications that you have to watch out for. And I have had patients ask me or particularly express that they feel like their mood has changed on this medicine. And it is a process of us having to go through, troubleshoot, and make sure that we still feel like benefits outweigh the risks.
And the course of therapy in terms of instructing patients, they have to learn how to self-inject. Is that a problem? Is that pretty simple?
Typically pretty simple. There's really clear guides in terms of, that are released by the drug companies about how to use the medications. So for example, Wegovy, for example, comes in a cell, you know, it's already a pre-prepared dosing clicking pen that you just sort of press to the skin, and with the pressure, the needle is released and you wait. And there is actually an indicator, a little bar that turns from gray fully to yellow as the medication comes out so that you know that it is administered properly. So it's a really easy process. You know, just have to clean the skin, look for certain areas, either in the lower abdomen or upper thighs or upper arms. You want to use subcutaneous tissue and avoid any areas with stretch marks. But besides that, you just sort of press it into the skin and it releases itself. So very, very easy for patients.
And then after patients lose weight, is there a maintenance dose, or then do they not qualify for the medications?
I would say it depends on your insurance and depends on what your hemoglobin A1C is doing or what your blood sugars are doing, how long insurance will cover it for. Though I've certainly had several patients who maybe get coverage for 7 months, especially if they have a lower BMI, that maybe they're just 31 and they've lost a significant amount of weight on the medication. And then when their prior authorization runs out and their approval runs out and we go to prescribe again, it's no longer covered. And that does pose a lot of problems for patients. You absolutely can regain the weight in that scenario if we didn't also make other lifestyle choices and changes up while they're doing this, while they're using the medication, many patients will gain back the weight.
And in terms of concerns about long-term side effects, thyroid cancers?
Yeah, and I would say jury's not necessarily out yet. So, I mean, right now there is certainly there have been some cases of cholecystitis. There have been some cases of pancreatitis. There have been some concern about increased incidence of thyroid cancer in animal models. But earlier this year in January, there was an observational study that was released that did show an increased incidence of all types of thyroid cancer, so papillary, follicular, medullary, and anaplastic, but it was observational, right? So there hasn't been a real randomized control trial that's demonstrated the same power of data, but it is something that I counsel with my patients ahead of time that we might just not know yet.
And do you have any absolute risk or even relative risk data compared to similar patients not on these therapies?
Unfortunately, no. There's only been observational studies thus far, and they haven't been very highly well-powered. It hasn't been well-studied.
And do you do any scanning? Because I know that thyroid cancer is one of those cancers similar to prostate and breast in older people that can be overdiagnosed, meaning there can be cancer on biopsy, but it's not something that's going to progress or kill the person.
Absolutely. So there's no scanning that I would do unless I had a reason. So I would do a thyroid exam at every single visit when they're on the medications in person. If I found any nodules, of course, I would evaluate with imaging. And then I warn them ahead of time, if you have any changes in voice, trouble swallowing, if you notice any, you know, lumps, bumps right in that area, then you have to kind of let me know immediately so we can evaluate and go from there. Same with abdominal pain with reference to any cholecystitis, gallbladder issues, pancreatitis, or incidence there. But I actually had an interesting, and anybody who has a history of medullary thyroid cancer or MEN syndrome in particular, I typically don't start the medications. But I had a patient today with Li-Framini syndrome, which potentially increases your risk of pancreatic cancer, of thyroid cancer. She did have a history of breast cancer, you know, currently on some medications for that, Lupron and Tamoxifen. And we had a discussion. She was trying to lose the weight and she knew, you know, my weight and obesity is also contributing to my cancer risk.
Yeah.
So
yeah.
Even knowing that this, you know, there's a question mark, a gray area in terms of the data and risk with the GLP medications, her choice was to take the medication.
Yeah. Well, just shared decision-making, just like within every condition. And the mechanism of action of these agents in terms of just the physiologic effects? Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So, and how I talk about it with my patients in terms of what they can expect to see. So GLP in particular is one of the most important hormones in the hunger pathways. So it overall will work to decrease appetite, but particularly to increase satiety. And then I would say a little bit less understood is how it works to really affect the reward pathways in reference to food and decrease those cravings. But we know it has those other very solid functions. And I would say there's a lot of data, too, that after bariatric surgery procedures, it's not just the fact that the volume of your stomach yeah. is smaller. It's the fact that you have higher GLP levels that really leads to weight loss.
So do you think there's going to be less referrals to patients for bariatric surgery given the explosion of the new pharmacologic agents that we have?
I absolutely think so.
And I know that at least in this area, I see there's a lot of patients that are going to these weight loss centers that they're getting compounded things to inject at less expense. And, you know, I'm sure that's not a good thing to do. It's not regulated. It's kind of similar to the hormone concoctions and pellets and crazy things that, you know, unfortunately we all see. And, you know, people are desperate because their doctors won't treat their menopausal symptoms, so they go elsewhere. And I'm sure it's the same thing in the obesity field. You know, people are just told, oh, just exercise a little more and eat less. Mm-hmm. And, you know, they've already tried all those things and they're at their wit's end. So do you have any handle on what are they doing? And is this a cheaper option? You know, have you seen disasters? Do you have any professional perspective on this?
Yeah, I mean, so far I have had some patients go this route. There are certainly certain applications, certain computer programs that particularly go and direct you to compounding pharmacies, exactly like you're talking about, you know, similar to compounded hormone therapy that women do sometimes get prescriptions for lower cost doses, which they claim is the same medication, the same GLP-1, the same concentration, though we can't actually say what exactly is in it. I've also had patients getting a lot of medications from Canada, either driving across the border or figuring out some other method. And Canada actually recently, I just got an email today that they're going to put, they're sort of cracking down on that, on their distribution to any American patients. So we may lose that as a resource at this point, but it's certainly less expensive there than it is here.
I know the endocrinologists do that for some of the diabetic medicines, and certainly
we have, right, as well in regard to hormone therapy. I haven't seen any disasters yet, but I think it's just because these are sort of, it's new on the forefront, so we'll see how that evolves.
Well, we will definitely have to bring you back, Dr. Iyer, certainly on our regular Speaking of Women's Health podcast. And thank you so much for joining us. This is the Menopause Learning CME. Please go to menopauselearning.com to answer your questions and collect your free CME. You can find us on Convey Medical, and you can go to speakingofwomenshealth.com for both CME and also podcasts for your patients. Thanks for joining me in the Sunflower House. I'm Dr. Holly Thacker, and you have been listening to a menopause and obesity expert, Dr. Tara Iyer. And please join us for our next future CME. Thank you.